I'm Lily. Welcome to OnDemand.Church. I'm so glad you've landed here today. OnDemand.Church exists to inspire you right where you are. I understand that you could be underneath a tree, laying in a hammock, enjoying the sunny weather, or you could be drinking hot cocoa inside, snuggled up, watching it snow. There are a few different ways you could be watching this right now. You could be watching on our website at OnDemand.Church, or you could be on our YouTube channel. If you are watching on our website, click on the bottom right here where it says YouTube, and you will be taken to our YouTube channel to watch this service. The best part about this is that you will be connected with an online community of people who are being inspired by this service. While you're watching on our YouTube channel, would you do a couple things? Would you subscribe, give a thumbs up, and also leave some comments. Maybe leave what sticks out in your mind from today or what inspired you. This will help us create the online community that will change lives. Speaking of YouTube, here at OnDemand.Church, we love checking out what's trending online, especially on YouTube. We love videos here, and we found an awesome shark attack video. Now, it's not what you're expecting. The guy comes out of it safely, but it is really, really cool. So check this out, and I'll guide you through it. All right, so I'm gonna get you caught up to speed on a few things that are happening in this video. There's a guy, he's snorkeling underwater. He's got a GoPro and he's also got a harpoon in his left hand. Here in a second, you're gonna see the shark slowly, actually really quickly approaching the guy here to the left side of the screen. He's coming up. Thank God this guy had a harpoon in his hand. The shark attacks, there's blood. I don't like the shark that he's getting hurt. And here this guy's coming up for water because like I said, he's snorkeling. Who snorkels and tries to approach a shark? Again, thank God he had the harpoon. He comes up for air again, goes back down. As you can see, this thing is attached to him. He's gotta get that undone so that he can get away from the shark. Wow, I am so glad no one was hurt in that video. It was very intense, way too intense for me. Now you might be wondering, why are we showing this shark attack video at OnDemand.Church? I'm gonna tell you why. Actually, I'm gonna ask you, have you ever felt like your goals, your dreams, anything you've ever set out to do, have been attacked and you just can't finish them? Maybe you've even felt like they've been attacked by a real life shark. Well, today is gonna be perfect because we're gonna talk about what it's like when maybe our goals and our dreams do get attacked, but how to finish what we start and go after them hard. All right, guys, so we want you to do a couple things today. We want you to grab something that you can write your thoughts down on, whether it be an app on your phone or even an old school pen and paper. Also, we want you to be able to stick your headphones in or get to a place where you can just think about what's happening here. We want you to write your thoughts down because we know that if you write things down, you'll be able to commit that to memory. And when it comes to your goals, that's the first step in really chasing after them and being able to finish them. Second, we've read that when you go after your goals alone, you are more likely to not finish them. So maybe you'll put your goals in the comment section below or even post them on Facebook or send them in a text to someone so that they can come alongside you and cheer you on, do life with you so that you can accomplish these goals. For the next few moments, we're gonna give you an opportunity to write down some goals. This could be financial goals, relational goals, or even in your relationship with Jesus. Maybe it's that you want to trust him more. There's an awesome verse in the Bible in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that talks about this. It says, "This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone and a new life has begun." That being said, when we follow Jesus and begin to really trust in him, we are able to accomplish our goals. He makes all things new. So don't write your goals down based on what you didn't finish last year. Write them down knowing that Jesus is on your side and that he's running with you to accomplish these goals. As you write these goals down, we're gonna play an awesome song that you might be really encouraged by and find yourself dancing to. Now, it's all about how this year is gonna be your year. So be encouraged by that. And as you write your goals down, keeping Jesus in mind, know that you can pause if you need to write them down or stick those headphones in and listen and write your goals down afterwards. We want this to be an awesome and memorable experience for you. So check out this song, and I'm so excited to see what your goals are.
Brand new hope is forming, adventure take me there. It's a new day for me. I feel it in my bones, I feel alive, I am set free. It's a new day for me. And nothing in this world will interfere. This is my year. mostly now been looking for a sign. And I can feel inside of me that this season is mine. Just not my past. It's a new day for me. I feel it in my bones. I feel alive. I am set free. It's a new day for me. Nothing in this world will interfere. This is my year.
Let's take a second to pray. Dear God, thank you so much for just letting us know that you are going to change this year, that you are a new God and you want to make all things new for us. So I pray that as we put our trust in you, as we walk with you, that you would come in and radically change our lives, that you would bless our finances, our relationships, and any endeavor that we go after to, in the hopes to finish, Lord, that you will be with us. You will run this race with us, and so that we can give all the glory to you. So again, thank you, and I ask all these things in your son Jesus' name. Amen. Right now, we're going to give you an opportunity to give. And if in your goals you wrote down that you want to trust Jesus more, this is a perfect opportunity, because trusting him with your resources and your finances is really going to help you trust him with everything. And there are so many verses in the Bible that talk about how Jesus will come in and be faithful. So please trust him in this. And we're not asking you to do this because we need your resources. We really want to partner with you and inspire you to trust God with your finances and with your life. Here at OnDemand.Church, we make it really easy to give. You can text the word UNLOCK to 77977. If you're watching this on our website, you can click give on the main page, or just check out this video and it'll explain all the awesome ways to give here at OnDemand.Church. Much for your generosity. We truly believe that Jesus is going to come through with his word and bless a cheerful giver. So thank you. Now you might be wondering why I'm here leaning on a dresser. We are heading into an all new topic called finish. Scot's going to come up and use this as an illustration in finishing what you start. Starting is the easy part, but finishing isn't. So watch this as we make it a little bit easier to accomplish those goals you wrote down. I'll be back afterwards. So watch this, and I'll see you in a little bit.
Welcome to those that are here at Unlock Church and those that are on demand.church. Thank you so much for hanging with us today. I am excited about what we're talking about. Finish what you started. Starting is easy, finishing isn't. I love topics like this as an endurance athlete, because any race I've ever raced, it doesn't matter how much training I put into it, there's always the question. It might be the first 2 miles, might be halfway of the race. I ask myself, can I finish it? All of a sudden, it's the rubber meets the road. It gets a little bit painful. Something unexpected happens as I'm in the race. Do I want to keep going? And I've shared a lot of those different experiences here inside the different races that I have had. But what I do love is that up to this moment, every race that I have towed the line to, no matter if I've puked my brains out, had bike problems in an Ironman, I have finished what I started. I want it to be something that is it's a quality inside me. Now, it's something that I've had to develop. I've quit a few things in my life, and those things last forever. I remember going, even now as an adult, things that I quit in high school, wishing that I would have finished them, because, man, I know what it feels like to quit. I wonder, though, if I would have stayed in some of those things, what had happened? And again, it's part of my story. It's just the way it goes. But hey, I do wonder, man, if I wouldn't have quit that, if I wouldn't have given up, man, what would have happened? What I love about the sport that I do with the endurance athlete side of me is that I get to compete against the pros every time. Is that the gun goes off and I am in the mix with the pros. I think one of the funnest races I was ever a part of was a half Ironman in Florida where I got to race against Lance Armstrong. Now, I wasn't even close to Lance Armstrong. When the race was over, I edited down a picture because Holly snapped a picture of him and then me in the same spot, and I just put it like I was right next to him. Thing I love is any given race, I could beat a pro. I could. That's the drive. That's some of the reason I don't give up. Some of the reason I don't give up is because I know I'd have to stand up here and say, I quit. And quitting lasts forever. And so today, and over the next few weeks, hopefully we talk about something that would inspire you to not give up, to figure out how to keep going, to set goals in the new year and figure out how do I accomplish those goals. Probably for most of us, it looks like this. I have this little car cabinet, I guess. I was going to say dresser, but it's not. It's a car cabinet. My dad built this for me when I was very little, and my boys get to use it now. Each drawer, my boys get to put Hot Wheels in it. Today, it's empty. I want to use it to illustrate something that we probably do with goals. And these are a bit more of a category place, and I'm not going to put them in any particular order at this very moment. But if you can follow with me on it, you'll get it right. So you're going to make goals. If you already have, you probably did something like this. You got jobs, okay, so you got goals there. If you're a parent, you have goals, what kind of parents you want to be, or with your kids, what you're expecting them to be like at the end of the year. If you're married, your spouse, with your friends, maybe your relationship with Jesus, and then maybe your fitness, your health, right? These are really popular categories we use to form goals. We view it somewhat like this, that it's all departments in our lives. And most of you go, well, you just put it out of order. If you've been around church long enough or grew up in church, right, they always say Jesus is first. So let's put it in the order that we probably hear everybody. Your spouse and kids, you know, you're going to be something like this, trying to put it into an order that we all kind of go, yeah, that's it, maybe fitness for some of you is down there. Maybe this is a reality for some of you, right? That it's, yeah, Jesus first, then spouse, then kids, then job, then friends, then fitness. Maybe some of you are like, it's not fitness at all. There's just that you want it to be. Some of you are like, I want my fitness to be here, but it's not, right? This is how we function. It's compartmentalization. I don't even know if that's a word. If I made it up, awesome. Compartmentalization, right? This is how we function most of the time. And here's the problem with this thought, is that it is very difficult to compartmentalize everything because when we are working on our kids, that means we have to neglect our spouse because, well, no, I'm focused on this drawer right now. This drawer is kids. So, hey, spouse, you're not a part. This is me working on that. And I know with our spouses, we work together. So maybe it's with our friends. It's like, okay, I can't work out with my friends because that'd be weird. I really want to be focused on my fitness. It's when I'm in this drawer, I'm here. You really see it when it's with our relationship with Jesus, right? When I'm at church, I'm all about Jesus. Man, I hear what the guy's talking about. I'm into it. Or maybe you're OnDemand.Church and you're like, I'm into what they're saying. And then you log offline or you go home and you forget about Jesus. It's not that thought. I want to maybe today to present it a different way on how we should view our goals and especially our relationship with Jesus. Is that it is not a drawer system. It makes it easy for us to function, I think, when it's side drawer systems, because then I'm in this drawer right now, so right now I am with my fitness. That's what I'm focused on because I'm in this drawer right now, so I'm going to work out real hard, and once I get that done, then I can close that drawer, and then it'll be spouse time. What happens is that in those processes, unintentionally, we sometimes offend our spouse, our friends, our employer, because we're going, no, it's compartmentalizations. You have that area. I have that area. When I do marriage counseling, I always use the reference where the Bible talks about it's two becoming one. It's one. It's not separate lives, and you get your night to do your thing you want to do. It's like, how are we going to function as a team now? We are becoming one, so the difficult thing is two individuals becoming one, and inside that, it's like, how do we become one? I don't know. It takes a lifetime. Holly and I are trying to still figure it out. We hit bumps all the time, and it's like, how do we work this out? But I do realize that it comes back to the way we set goals, is that it is not compartments that we function inside, though it is very easy to manage it when we do that. This is easy because, I mean, I'm all about my spouse right now. That's it. Close it. I'm all about, you get it, right? So let's redo this, okay? Instead of trying to keep it priority number one, which we stated a second ago, it's your relationship with Jesus, right? Let's just pretend that's reality. Well, if we keep that number one, that means when we get into the other compartments, Jesus ain't anywhere in those anymore because he's here. Compartmentalization says, well, when I'm with Jesus, that's it. When I'm with my spouse, I don't have to be like Jesus because I'm not in that drawer right now. When I'm in my fitness, I don't have to think about how's this impact my kids right now, me being gone or me doing it. It doesn't impact that because I'm in that drawer. As an endurance athlete, there's a lot of time spent training. And you've got to figure out, especially as a dad of six, on how do you do that amount of training and not neglect your kids. I have to sometimes sacrifice a big goal on maybe it's time or something because my main priority is to do my training with my kids. So that means a lot of times I train on a trainer riding a bike while my kids are in the house and we might watch a movie together. I'm there with them and I'm riding a bike with them. Is it fun to ride a bike on a stationary for 4 hours? It is not, okay? In case you thought it might be, it is not. It really hurts the butt a lot more because you're not moving around. You're just sitting there. It's more mentally painful than physically, actually. What does it do? It allows me to do life with my kids and train together with my kids. And so if we can get away from the drawer mentality, here's what it is. Jesus is this compartment. He's the dresser. Now everything is inside this is in Jesus. And I'm not putting these in any form of. Now we view it through the lens of Jesus. It's like, let me use my Oakley snowboarding goggles here, right? I put these on and all of a sudden my view, and I look really cool with them on up here, it changes. The tint has changed the color of the room. I can't see as well because my view is changed. It's changed. This year, when you go to set your goals, it's viewing through the lens of Jesus. It is not viewing that, well, man, when I'm at church, I'll be about Jesus. He's a compartment that I'm. It's Jesus is in everything. That's how we begin setting the goals that actually we can accomplish when it's not isolated areas in our life. It's how does this all fit the big picture? I'm going to read from the author John, who actually records Jesus telling you and me who he is. He answers this question. John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I am the way. This verse since the beginning of the year has been just on my heart. I've been thinking about it almost every day. We talked about it at a small group this week because I just think it's so powerful. Jesus saying, I am the way. What is the way? The easiest illustration I got is if I came to one of you and said, I put $1 million where that fish house is and here's the way to go get it. And on your way to get the $1 million, you're like, okay, Scott told me the way, the direction I should be going. And all of a sudden somebody comes along and says, oh yeah, I kind of know what you're talking about. I have a quicker way to get there. And now you have to choose. Do you listen to the person that put the $1 million out there for you to have and listen to the way they say to go? Or do you listen to the person that says, I got a shortcut. I've not really been there before, but I think I can get you there quicker. In life, that's temptation. And we often default to the one that says, I can get you there quicker. Where Jesus is saying, no, I'm the way. I know how to get you there. The things you want in life, I know how to get you there. The goals you want to set this year, I know how to get you there. Follow the way. Follow me. Now, we're great in defining as people. We try to define following Jesus really quick, right? We try to say, we got to do this, and put it all into one. And now you're following Jesus. Here's what I want you to do. Back all the way up and just say, will you answer this question? Will you in the new year follow Jesus? will that be where you go, okay, now all the goals I make, if it's fitness, athletically, marriage, if you're a college student, make all those decisions and goals inside those, in the idea of I'm following Jesus, so what is the wise thing to do inside there? What are the wise goals inside that? Jesus is the dresser. He is the way. He knows how to get there because he's been there. And then he goes, I am the truth. The Bible says that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That means he's never changed, so he's always the same. He's constant. Don't you wish you had something constant? Look back in 2016. Don't you wish there were some? I look back at my last year. I'm like, wow, if there was a couple consistent things in my life, that'd be great. Jesus is constant. He is the truth. He'll never leave you or forsake you, it says. And then he's the life. I think a lot of times our perspective on who Jesus is, he wants to steal and rob our life. He wants to make life miserable. And I think that's what we as humans try to put around a relationship with Jesus is that, you can't do that. Oh, you can't do that now. And we begin to define what it is for everyone that look like they're following Jesus. Where all I know is when you read what Jesus says to his first disciples, they're fishing on a beach. Jesus walks up to them and says, follow me. And what do? They drop their stuff and they begin a life of following him. I'm saying follow Jesus this year and figure it out as you're going. We should view life through the lens of Jesus and nothing more if we are following. If he's the lens we view things through. So now, back up and go, what kind of parent are you going to be in 2017? What kind of athlete are you going to be? Why would fitness matter to you? If you look through the lens of Jesus, it's like, okay, wait, he's come to give me life and life more abundantly. Okay, so, man, if I get fit, I can live life. It's not about now keeping up with the Joneses. Well, man, I wish I could fit into those jeans. It's not about that. It's like, well, I want to experience the more abundant life Jesus has for me. Let me jump into what the author Luke writes in the book called Luke chapter 14, verse 25, it starts. This is a story of Jesus. You'll catch it as I'm reading it. I'll stop a little bit and break it down for you because immediately you're going to go, what? Jesus wants me to do what? Listen to this. One day when a large group of people were walking along with him, Jesus turned and told them, pause really quick. What I love about Jesus, he leverages every opportunity, right? He sees a big crowd. I can teach him something here. He didn't go, I'm tired, I'm exhausted. He sees a moment to leverage. One of the first things in going and finishing your goals is to leverage every opportunity. So anyways, Jesus leveraged a moment, and then this is what he says. Anyone who comes to me must refuse to let go. Sorry. Anyone who comes to me but refuses to let go of father, mother, spouse, children, brother, sister, yes, even one's own self can't be my disciple. So we talked about him a moment ago, right? Follow Jesus. And all of a sudden I read that. You're like, whoa, wait a second. What are you saying there? What? I have to not be around my parents. I have to not love that. What is Jesus talking about? Because I thought Jesus was all about love. And I thought Jesus was, hold on. Jesus isn't saying that you kick your family to the curb and you don't care about them. He's not saying, hey, you don't have goals with them. That's not what he's saying. He's trying to paint a picture of this. You must let go of the responsibility of. No, what do I mean by that? Is that you set goals inside those, but the goals are through the lens of Jesus. And when the lens becomes, okay, what does Jesus want in those relationships? You understand now you are helping inspire those around you to go after their God-given greatness. It's Jesus coming along. It's you're giving up control. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is in Proverbs chapter 6. It actually talks about ants. And when I first really read this verse and it jumped out to me, I was in Peru. I was down there helping a church down there. When I was there, we went in further into the jungle, and the guy taking us, he's like, hey, come to this big mound of dirt. He's like, break it open, and then let all these termites climb on you. And it was really freaky when you got all these termites climbing all up on you. Like, how long do I let? And he's like, all right, now smash them all over the place. And you start smashing them. He's like, rub them all over your body, and it begins to smell like off. He's like, this is our bug repellent. It's really cool. You just smash them up. I'm like, so that's what they're doing. The company of Off is just collecting termites and putting them in a can. And so we rub off on our rub termites on us, go way into the jungle, and then they bring us to this place where these boulder ants are. Boulder ants are like 2 inches. They're these massive black ants that in the jungle, they use these ants as their sutures, their stitches. They'll grab the black or the bullet ant, put it on the cut, and then they squeeze the ant. The ant's pinchers close the skin, pull it, and they break the head off, and the head stays there and keeps the wound closed together. They call them bullet ant because when they bite you, they say it feels like you just got shot. And we're going in, and I see these ants going around a tree, and I'm like, they're huge. And then they begin to tell the story of the bullet ant. And then that night or the next morning, I read Proverbs chapter 6, where it begins to talk about the ant. And listen to this. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6. You lazy fool, look at an ant. Watch it closely. Let it teach you a thing or two. Nobody has to tell it what to do. I love that part right there. No one has to tell it what to do. That's what I'm like thinking for a moment. I'm like, oh, okay, sure. I didn't know that about ants. Here's the author in the Proverbs is saying, no one tells it what to do. All summer, it stores up food. At harvest, it stockpiles provisions. So how long are you going to laze around and do nothing? How long before you get out of bed? A nap here, a nap there, a day off there. Sit back, take it easy. Do you know what comes next? Just this. You can look forward to a dirt poor life, poverty, your permanent house guest. You're like, whoa, that's heavy, right? That inspired me to always get up and go. This is not to me about money or being really well. This is about getting the most out of life. Get up and move. Again, through the lens of Jesus, all of a sudden I read that going, oh, wait, yeah, I got to get after it. Now, this is not a conversation, never have a day off. Days off, Jesus talks about, he refers to the Ten Commandments where you have a Sabbath day, a day of rest. It is wise to have a day of rest. You cannot work 7 days a week and not go crazy. Just if you're married, just ask your spouse, okay? They'll let you know. You got to have a day of rest. What are the goals Jesus wants you to go after? In the light of following Jesus, what are the goals to pursue? Because we can have big dreams, right? Like massive dreams. We all have those. But what is the step today going? What's the wise thing to do today? Here's what I'm going to try to be in 10 years. You still have to have 10 years goals. I talked about that. You have those, but you're not living in the 10-year mode. You're living in, okay, what's the wise thing to do today? I'm not promised tomorrow, so therefore I got to treat people kind today. I have to be what Jesus has called me to do today and not say tomorrow I will do it. Tomorrow I will apologize. Tomorrow I will... Tomorrow is always tomorrow, right? Oh, I will get in shape on Monday. I'll start eating right on Monday. Well, no, man, I didn't know we were having an office party on Monday. I'll start on Tuesday. What? I just overslept, so I ate a candy bar on the way out. Okay, Wednesday. Tomorrow, right? We all know that. We're all guilty of tomorrow becomes tomorrow. It's today. Seize today. I've had a goal since 27 years old in my endurance athletic side of things. I want to run in Boston. Like 3 years ago, I missed it by 7 minutes and really bummed. It's taken me now 11 years. I'm at it again this year. I'm trying to qualify for Boston this year. Spoke to my coach last week. She's going to begin training me. I don't know if I'm going to get there, but I know that in going for it, I'm going to be better for pursuing the goal of trying to be in the shape to run a marathon that fast. The process is sometimes the point. It's not always do you finish what you in the actual goal, but I'm going to finish, meaning I'm going to race. I'm going to go to the marathon. And if I don't actually finish it, right, meaning get the goal, I will finish the race. But if I don't hit the target, guess what? I just back up, go, okay, I've learned one way not to train for it. I'm going to do it again. When I was 27 years old, setting out, I want to run Boston. I ran for 3-4 years, got really close, but not fast enough. I jumped into the Ironman side of stuff to develop different sides of my muscles to make me faster as a runner. It complemented my original goal. It's been an 11-year goal now to get to Boston. Now, some of the advantages, the older I get, the time has to be slower. And so that's okay, you know, it's working for me, I suppose. But it's not that much slower. I wish it was like by 20 minutes. It's only by like 2 or 3 minutes every 5 years. So eventually, if I don't get there by the 60, 70-year-old, I'm in, as long as they don't change it. Here, my point in that is saying I've been after a goal for 11 years. And I've never quit running because I didn't get to the initial deal. It's because I know I am better for the training that I have done and pursuing and continuing to try to figure out. Failure is not bad as long as you learn from it. Failure is not bad as long as we learn from it. See, the Bible teaches against two extremes. Never set a goal, never setting goals and setting goals with no thought of Jesus. The balance is the key, figuring out how to merge those things together. I'm going to set goals, but through Jesus' eyes. Go back to James as we wrap this up. James chapter 4, verse 15. James writes, "You are cheating on God if all you want is your own way." Because Jesus wants to give you life, right? And so his way might not line up to our way all the time. If all you want is your own way, flirting with the world every chance you get, you end up enemies of God and his way. And do you suppose God doesn't care? The Proverbs has it that he's a fiercely jealous lover. And what he gives in love is far better than anything else you'll find. It's common knowledge that God goes against the willful proud. God gives grace to the willing humble. I want us to move to the first step in finishing what we started is Jesus be the lens we view everything through. And asking the question, if I'm going to follow Jesus, what does that mean for our goals? And so your homework. This is you to walk out of here to make goals, but with Jesus as the filter. Make fitness goals. I really love all of these categories. Jesus is here. What's your fitness goal this year? What's your health? Instead of going, man, I want to drop 100 pounds, you just go, man, I want to drop 5. Make it where you can do it, where it's actually doable. And spread it over 5 years, going, okay, in 5 years, I'd like to be here, but I'm going to work on this right now. Every day, I'm going to wake up, and I'm going to do 5 push-ups. Your goal might be to do 1,000 a day, but back down to go 5. I can do 5 right now. That's better than what I was doing yesterday. You might not be able to run a marathon, but you can walk a mile. Maybe you can't walk a mile. You can walk to your car. You can walk up steps instead of taking an elevator. It's just making it as simple as possible, your fitness. Your goal is in your job. Not just to be promoted, but to be a better employee with your friends. Is it spend more time? Maybe is it to go, okay, I don't need to be around those friends because they're not following Jesus right now. I'm trying to follow Jesus and they're not helping me. And so I'm going to make new friends. Maybe that's jumping into a small group, a goal. Okay, I want to jump into a small group because it's going to help me with my friends. It's going to help me with my relationship with Jesus. It's going to actually help me in all a bunch of different categories. Because all of a sudden I go to a small group and they help me in my relationship with my spouse, as a parent, as a coworker. I'm going to go to church more because those things are going to help me because we're learning about Jesus in the way. These are for you to make your goals. And ask this question as you're doing, who do you want to be, not what do you want to do? At the end of 2017, who do you want to be, not what do you want to be doing? That's the question. What's the drive when I go back to the athletic side for me? It is not, I do not want to be a triathlete or a marathon runner. I want to be a better dad. I want to be a better husband. I want to be a better follower of Jesus. And as I am in better shape, the more energy I have, it helps in all those other areas. That's the drive. And you know, as I keep pursuing that, yeah, I set goals in that because I think that's the wise thing to do. Would you just close your eyes for a second? And this is where you are taking a step in your relationship with Jesus. Maybe some of you are going to just simply say in your heart today, I'm going to follow Jesus this year. And you're going to figure that out. And it just starts with that. I'm going to follow Jesus this year. Some of you, you got to back up and go, I need goals that I can achieve, measurable goals. But you got to start them. And you need to have that conversation with Jesus. Okay, I'm following you, but now through your lens, I need to make these goals, all of my goals through you. Jesus, I just pray right now that you're nudging hearts, that you're pressing buttons in areas in their life that we know that we need to get on fixing, that we need to get on and achieve some goals in those areas in our lives. That over the next few weeks, we would be inspired to make godly goals, that we would then have the energy to go after those goals, and that at the end of this year, that we would be better people, better husband or wife, or better college student, better just people in general, better friend. Give us those areas in our lives that we need to have measurable goals in. Jesus, we thank you for you being the way, the truth, and the life, and that we can simply follow you. So may we follow you all the days of our lives. In your name, amen. Thank you guys for hanging today.
Thank you so much for hanging out with us today. I'm so glad you watched. I am actually really excited to start my goals this year and implement some of the things that we learned from this first teaching of the series, Finish. One more thing, would you please subscribe to this channel so that you can be updated with what's happening here at OnDemand.Church? Please give us a thumbs up. Please like our page. Please comment below so that you can be inspired, so that we can inspire others and really go after our goals this year.